Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins, and here's what's happening tonight. Have you ever wondered what old-school Republicans think of the current state of the GOP? Well, we had the unique opportunity to speak with former Republican Senator Alan Simpson, where we got an answer to that question. And Republicans aren't going to like what he has to say. And we're taking your questions from Twitter. Send it to us using the hashtag AskROF. And that's what's coming up tonight. You've just stepped in to the Ring of Fire.
There's been zero warming, none whatsoever.
I'm running for president of the United States.
Congress declares war, not the president. Start with the countries that are burning our flags.
We regret these errors and apologize.
We apologize.
We apologize.
And apologize.
This is good news, people.
Let's start tonight with your Twitter questions. If you have a question for us that you want us to answer, send it using the hashtag AskROF. Our first question tonight comes from Carl Wallstrom, who asks, if Sanders doesn't become the Dems nominee, what will become of the future of his campaign, and has he changed America for a generation? Bernie Sanders' campaign and his entire career in politics that now the public knows about and understands has absolutely changed America for a generation. And what I mean by that is I don't mean for the next, 30 years, things are going to be different. What I mean is that he has changed a generation. The 18 to 35 year olds that overwhelmingly support Bernie Sanders, hopefully they will never lose that passion and that fire that he gave them. The inspiration that he provided to those people will hopefully last a lifetime, because if it does, that is going to reshape American politics. It's going to change the Democratic Party. It's going to change the Republican Party. And it's going to change both in a good way, the way that they need to go, the way where they rule for the people and not for the corporations. We have proven during this election cycle, even if Bernie Sanders doesn't end up with a nomination, we have proven that you can have a successful presidential campaign that doesn't take corporate money. We have proven that the power and the desires of the American public is more powerful than corporate influence. That's what Bernie Sanders is. That's what this movement is all about. And he's not talking about crazy ideas that is, socialism, or as some people are now calling it, communism. He's talking about things that at one time in this country were actually the way things were. He's talking about doing things the way that all of the other countries in the world already do. Universal healthcare is not socialism. It's what Canada does. It's what the United Kingdom does. It's what most of Europe does and all other industrialized developed nations around the world. They all do it. We're the only ones that don't. Don't you think that's a little backwards? Aren't we supposed to be the leaders in the world? Free college education. Again, go over to Europe. Very common. Africa, Asia. Happens in most countries across the planet. Not here in the U.S. No. Fork over your money, take out these exorbitant student loans, and then you can go to college. You'll never be able to repay them, and it's going to cripple you for the next 30 years. But that's how we're going to do college here in the United States. And that is what this age group, the 18 to 35-year-olds, that Bernie Sanders generation, they understand that that is not how you accomplish things, that you can't have a successful country when you burden the ones who are going to inherit the mess that you've left them. And that's what we're looking at now with that age group. Everyone coming of age, they've been in the workforce for 10 to 15 years, maybe at most, and they see that the system is rigged from the inside and they want it to change. And as long as they keep that passion, as long as they keep the lessons that Bernie Sanders has been trying to beat into our heads, then yes, he has changed American politics forever and for the better. Next up, we have a question from Twitter user @WriterEula, who asks, why is it that we can point out all the flaws of the GOP, but when we point out Hillary's flaws, her camp vilifies us? This is probably one of the best questions I've ever seen, just because this is an issue that makes me so angry. Because it's not just the fact that they vilify you. It's the fact that they downplay the problems that we have with Hillary. When we talk about the money that she received from speeches, or the corporate money going to her campaign, or the fundraisers that are being hosted by NRA lobbyists, defense industry lobbyists, Wall Street lobbyists, oh, no. It's Hillary Clinton, so those don't matter. Don't worry about that. The money doesn't influence her. Really? Because it influences every single other politician that takes corporate money. Because that's what a good journalist does. Whenever they write a story about a politician, they immediately talk about the money behind their decision to do whatever it is they're doing. If they just voted to open up, 200 square miles of mountains for the coal industry, you better believe we're going to look at their donations from the coal industry and see how that influenced their decision. Now, according to some of Hillary's corporate media supporters, well, that doesn't prove a quid pro quo. No, it doesn't, actually. It doesn't. You're absolutely right. You can't prove that this was bribery. But you also can't prove that it was bribery when the Bush administration gave Halliburton all those no-bid contracts to do work in Iraq. You can't prove it, but it's there. I mean, and what's funny is that you even have some people like Joe Connison who've made the remarks about, oh, it doesn't matter that Hillary takes this money, it doesn't influence her. This is the same guy that used to be very credible who wrote a book about how Halliburton and the oil industry influenced every decision made by the Bush administration in their decision to invade Iraq. So you can't have it both ways, Hillary Clinton supporters. Either money is an issue and you can be mad at her for doing it, or money is not an issue for any politician and we should just leave Citizens United in place as it is and say, screw it. I am so sick of the apologists. It's ridiculous. So many formerly good reporters and personalities on the progressive side have lost all of their credibility trying to support Hillary Clinton, that it's really destroyed a lot of the progressive media. A lot of familiar faces that used to appear on this show, you haven't seen them in a while. And do you know why? It's because their defense of Hillary Clinton contradicts everything that they have done throughout their career, and I am not about to put another hypocrite on this program. So they could be mad. They can get angry at the Bernie people and say, you're going to cost us this election. No, Hillary Clinton is going to cost you this election. And you're going to lose to the easiest to beat Republican candidate in American history. And it's because of you, apologists. You are alienating and pissing off the progressive base who wanted Bernie Sanders, but maybe would support Hillary. But it's because of people like you that they won't. I hope that answers your question. I know I got a little off topic, but it's such an infuriating issue. Our next question comes from Big Guy Movie Review, who asks, is it possible to make a third party that can compete with the two-party illusion that we have now? It absolutely is. And to be honest, we have some good third parties out there. The problem is that even when we're in school, in middle school, in high school, and we learn history and civics, they beat it into our head that it's a two-party system. We are indoctrinated with that knowledge from such a young age that most people are brought up to think that there is nothing you can do to change it. And that's absolutely not true. I mean, if Bernie Sanders hadn't switched from an independent to a Democrat, because for his career before this, he was an independent, not a Democrat, he'd be winning right now. He would absolutely hands down be winning. And he wouldn't have to go through all this primary BS that we've seen. And so I find that to be one of Bernie's biggest mistakes. He could have been the leader of a real third-party movement in America. And once we get that third party to finally take a seat of power in this country, that is the easiest and fastest way to make those other parties relevant and do away with the stranglehold that the Democrats and the Republicans have on this country. Because when we look through the last 40 years, two accomplishments have been made by either Republicans or Democrats, good or bad. Republicans killed the labor movement with Ronald Reagan. Democrats gave us the Affordable Care Act. Not perfect, but it was a huge step forward that is, you know, finally gave insurance coverage to millions of Americans. But those are about it. Two major accomplishments, and one of them is horrible and has been horrible for the country. That's what the two-party system gives you. A lot of status quo, a lot of status quo, occasionally a change. Change will come a lot quicker if we can get third-party candidates elected. And so the way you do that is go back to Howard Dean's 50-state strategy. You don't have to automatically go for high office. Go for local offices and work your way up. You know, support a candidate for dog catcher that's a member of the Green Party and get them exposure and get them up, get them out there. That's the only way we're going to do it unless we have a massive character like Bernie Sanders run for president with a third party. Other than that, you work from the bottom up and you support those local races and state races and get that recognition and that power in the third parties on the small level and then build from there. Our final question tonight comes from George Ryder, who asks, the GOP speaks and acts with impunity. Is this the result of gerrymandering? You know, this is a very interesting question because we've seen a lot of people say that, oh, the Republicans wouldn't be so crazy. They wouldn't go out there and say all these outlandish things if they weren't in such a safe district and they knew that they can win re-election no matter what. Now, to an extent, I do believe that. But for the most part, I don't buy it. I mean, this has been happening so much. And again, the Republicans have only had control of the House for, you know, 4 or 6 years. 6 years. That's not that long. So 6 years ago, the Democrats ran things with, you know, relatively similar districts to what we have today. So I don't completely buy the gerrymandering argument. I think it's a cop-out. I think that's Democrats just saying like, oh, well, they just say those things are in a safe district. Let's write it off. Let's move on to the next one. It's because the Democrats don't want to fight. They don't want to go out there and say you shouldn't say things like this because you're alienating huge sections of the American population. You just insulted a religion, or you just insulted a race, or you just insulted a sexual preference. They don't want to call these people out. They think it's, you know, oh, it's beneath us. We're not going to get into the same fights. You're never going to win if you don't get into a fight. Sorry, that's how fights work. So if a Republican is fighting you and you say, well, they're in a safe district, I'm not going to deal with it, you've already lost. Stop using the gerrymandering argument as a cop-out. Gerrymandering is a huge problem, and it has to be fixed. But that's not the reason Republicans are as crazy as they are. They're as crazy as they are because we don't have enough Democrats willing to get out there and fight back on the campaign trail. So gerrymandering, again, we've got to do something about it. But more importantly, we've got to do something about the craziness coming from the Republican Party, and that's not going to happen until everybody's willing to go out there, shine a spotlight on it, and publicly shame them and let them know that you're not going to tolerate it. And that's all the time we have for questions tonight, but if you have a question that you want answered, send it to us on Twitter using the hashtag AskROF. You can follow the show on Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio, and you can follow me at Farron Balanced. And to finish out our interviews that we recorded during the Mass Torts Made Perfect seminar in Las Vegas a few weeks ago, we're bringing you something different tonight, a Ring of Fire first. Tonight, we're speaking to a Republican. And not just any Republican, it's former Senator Alan Simpson. Now, I do not agree with many of his policies or what he has to say about Bernie Sanders in the interview that's about to air. But it was a unique opportunity for us to speak with a Republican about the current state of the Republican Party. So let's take a look. So I'm sitting here with the former Senator Alan Simpson. You served as both a senator and in the House of Representatives for more than 30 years. You have military service in your background, trial lawyer in your background and in your present, teacher,
You've pretty much done it all. But another distinction that I have to give you is you are the first Republican we have had on Ring of Fire. So I appreciate that. And actually building off of that, because you served at a time in Washington where there was disagreement between both parties, as there always has been, but things were still accomplished. You know, there were disagreements constantly, but at the end of the day, there was this sense of we have to still do things, we have to govern, and we have to pass laws. Contrast that with what we see today. And we have people like Ted Cruz and Marco Rubio who say, look, we're not going to do anything. We're going to shut down the government when we feel like it. I want to get your opinion on the current state of, I guess you'd call them, the Republican leadership in Washington.
Well, that would take a while. But let me just say the reason I'm here is because of Michael Berg. And he is my partner, the senior partner. And to be here when he's to receive the award of the National Trial Lawyer Hall of Fame is a great honor and privilege for me, because we've been together 18 years or so, and there's just not a finer man, a finer human being. As all you heard this program this morning, your people haven't, but it was about, you know, in the essence, you come down to humanity. Who are we representing? People who are in need, and trial lawyers are, as I always refer to them, as being accountable. They want to make people accountable. You're always saying, why doesn't the congressman be accountable? Why don't our teachers be accountable? Why doesn't this and that? Well, that's what trial lawyers do. Back to the Republican Party, best described as a mess, and the fact if this weren't a family program, I'd have a more graphic assessment of the situation. But, I mean, you know, this is madness, so I came out this week. You may, by the time here, you can cut through this. John Kasich, he's the only one on our side of the aisle that has had experience in running anything. When you have two people running for the presidency, one of them wants to erect a 30-foot wall, and the other wants to carpet bomb the earth. Well, you really ought to start thinking again about where you are, but I do think at the convention it's going to be a bloodbath. I'm so glad I'll miss it. And I wouldn't want to be there at all, because don't forget the key is what people are saying, especially Ryan. He's saying, I don't know what you're going to do in Cleveland, but it won't be me. It's got to be somebody who was in the fray. Well, all those that are in the fray are out of the fray except Kasich. I mean, Jeb is gone and Christie is gone and all the rest of the higher and lesser lights. Lindsey Graham, a great guy. So it will be. Republicans have a wonderful philosophy. They give each other the saliva test of purity, and then they lose, and then they bitch for 4 years. That's how they work.
Well, it's very interesting, because when you look at, you know, kind of what the Republican Party is all about, and then you look at who is running as a Republican or even governing as a Republican, and it seems almost counterintuitive. They want smaller government, and yet at the same time, they want to legislate and dictate everything down to the moral fiber, like with Ted Cruz and wanting to ban sex toys. That seems like a government overreach. That seems
like
a big
government. Don't leave out the Democrats. I mean, look at Bernie here. I mean, for heaven's sakes, you got a socialist running for the president of the United States. That's just as spooky as Cruz. To me, as a Republican or a guy with a brain, what's more spooky than a socialist and a religious zealot? So my wife and I got tired of what was happening in our county, so we ran for precinct committee man and woman. That's what we did 50 years ago, and we got elected. And we were at the convention, and somebody came up with this resolution that said, the primary purpose of marriage is procreation. Well, I waited a while on that one, and then I got up and I said, if any of you really believe this, you're really missing a hell of a lot of fun. It didn't go well. One woman fainted. Several clutched their shriveled breasts and fell forward into their plates. Yeah, anyway, it's a nut house, and there's no other, but you know, you don't want to just spend time whacking on one party. There's plenty of whacking to be done all around.
I agree 100%.
And don't forget what's happening, so you don't forget. People of America are smarter than their elected officials. They always have been. The thing works. We've had, 44 presidents, and we can only remember 10 of them. We've had jerks for president. And so here we go into this great mess again, but we will prevail. The country will prevail. And at the convention, God knows what will happen. Trump may pick up his marbles and run with it. Bernie could easily pick up his marbles and run with it, too. He thinks he's getting diddled. So, and then don't forget, people don't vote for anybody. They vote against.
Right.
My father was a governor and U.S. senator. And he lost a re-election as governor. And the next day, we were sitting in a booth in Grable, Wyoming. You've never heard of Grable, Wyoming.
Right.
Well, in the booth next door, this couple of cowboys said, well, we got rid of that son of a bitch Simpson, didn't we? The other guy said, yeah, we did. Who'd we get? And the other guy said, who cares? And that's what's out there with Hillary. That's what's out there with Trump. That's what's out there with Bernie. Don't forget. And the American people are so confounded by this babble, fed by a media, which is, I mean, how long do we have to go? 3 years of seeing the race to the White House back in, I mean, for the God's sake, give us a break, 24/7 madness.
Well, you know, it's interesting you bring that up because what we've seen from our audience is that, and just, you know, general people, if Hillary is on the Democratic side and Trump is on the Republican side, the Democrats aren't voting for Hillary, they're voting against Trump. And the Trump people aren't voting for him, they're voting against Hillary. And it kind of does go just back to that divide. Everything really is divided, and I don't see civility really from either party, because the Republicans would get on the media and say the Democrats are not working with us on this, the Democrats do the same thing. There's no more unity. There is no more of that sense of, look, I disagree with you fundamentally on issues, so how do we work this out? How do we get legislation that everybody, you know, we may not think it's perfect, it may not be perfect, but we're going to get things done. And I feel like from both sides, that doesn't exist anymore.
No, it doesn't. And so I'm the master of lost causes. I was on the Iraq study group. That was five Dems, five Republicans. We agreed on every word. Jim Baker, Lee Hamilton, Leon Panetta, Sandra Day O'Connor, wonderful group of people, Chuck Roth. We come out of there agreeing on every word, handed it to the Bush administration, and they adopted about five of our suggestions. Later, they adopted 50 of them, okay? And then the president appoints Erskine Bowles and me as co-chairman of the National Commission on Fiscal Responsibility and Reform. We get five Democrats, five Republicans, one independent, that's 60% of the 18, ranging from Dick Durbin of Illinois to Tom Coburn of Oklahoma. So you don't need to even think of describing things about people who say, if we had bipartisanship, we could make it work. They don't give a damn about it. And it didn't start in Congress. It started in the city hall. It started in the school board of your district. Somebody started throwing the hack jobs on each other, and that's how it started, or running out on the ball field and hitting the player over the head, or killing the cheerleader's mother. This stuff didn't start in Congress, and it's not going to stop in Congress. It'll stop when civility takes place in little towns all over America and school board meetings instead of people getting up and throwing things, or city council meetings. That's what this is about. This is not the great ogre of Congress unable to agree. It's the ogre down in the bow wows where people are, you know, the television programs show smart ass kids and dumb parents. I mean, and you can, on Sirius Radio, you can pick up, I thought I knew more words than George Carlin, but I missed a couple. You can pick that up on Sirius Radio. It's all part of a debasement that doesn't have a damn thing to do with Congress, has to do with America.
Well, and you know, that kind of brings us full circle back to your role as a trial lawyer. And I feel I work around a ton of trial lawyers. I mean, Mike Papantoni, I work with Michael Berg every week, and Howard Nations. And that is what the role of a trial lawyer is. It's trying to bring some civility, you know, trying to fight back against, you know, the rampant, you know, corruption and just misdeeds, and fighting for the little guy, for the victim. And that to me is where civility is regained. And hopefully, as we continue, as you continue and all of the other great trial lawyers out there, we gain some of that back. And that's, you know, one of the things, I know trial lawyer has such a negative connotation to some people, but it really is remarkable what you do every day and how it changes this country.
But as again, not to address something that's unseen as we sit here, but just moments ago, this marvelous speaker talked about the stereotype of a trial lawyer. It wasn't nice. He talked about the stereotype, Mr. Swinger, you know, the adult, you know, touching the chicks and the drunk, and you know, that's out of tune. Trial lawyers work like dogs, and they work for justice. I know that sounds corny, but they do. They work for the aggrieved and the stricken and the ill and the people who have suffered at the hands of arrogance and pomposity. And especially when you see this great divide in America, of which Bernie talks about day and night, and others talk about day and night, it's real. So how do you ease the people back from the edge of the cliff? And trial lawyers have a chosen mission to change things and to make people accountable and afflict the comforted and comfort the afflicted, and that's what they do. And a guy like Mike Berg, I've watched him. I don't know when he sleeps, doesn't eat right. You know, I want to track him. I like my son, I whack him. I don't whack my sons. They're both trial lawyers with this firm, and they're both ace trial lawyers. They really are, they're listed. So it's a joy to be involved with a firm. I'm very proud that they use my name, and that Michael Berg is one of the finest in America, as chosen by his peers. But trial lawyers, like everybody, have to do something with their image. We all, politicians, I mean, I'm a politician. I was. And I've always been active in the social issues. I've been a conservative with regard to fiscal matters, and was proven to be so. And in certain circles now within the Republican Party, I'm known simply as a baby-killing, queer-loving son of a bitch. So that's America today, and it ain't going to change until you weed out these cuckoos who love to use emotion, fear, guilt, or racism to make their cause because they ran out of facts. And nobody's entitled to their own, they're entitled to their own opinion, but not their own facts. And it's up to trial lawyers to peel back the onion and slap them around and teach them some tricks.
Alan Simpson, thank you for talking with us today. And thank you for everything that you have done. We appreciate it.
Well, I could have been king, but they wouldn't have anything to do with it. It broke my heart. No, I don't.
Thank you very much.
And that's all the time we have for today, but you can get more news at our website, theringoffire.com, and you can subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/goleftTV. I'm Farron Cousins, and we'll see you tomorrow.